Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to today's Track C presentations. And my name is Jim Lee. I'll be the moderator for this entire track. We have a great topic to begin our day, but before I introduce our speaker, just as a reminder, and I'm sure you all know by now, if you have comments or questions, please enter them into the FeedLoop chat area, which I'll be monitoring throughout the presentation. But I'm assured that we will also have time at the end of the presentation to take questions as well. Our speaker today will also be available in the networking area immediately following his presentation in the Track C networking area. So without further ado, let me introduce Louis-Pierre Guillaume. He's with the AMALT Digital Transformation and Collaboration Innovation Area. Is the former director at Schneider Electric Knowledge, who were finalists for the 2017 KM World Reality Awards, were MAKE Award winners, and significant contributors to an APQC study on communities of practice, the next generation. Louis-Pierre is a consultant and a lecturer specializing in knowledge management. As the head of AMALT, he helps organizations to foster their digital transformation and collaborative innovation to enhance the value of knowledge, very important. He's over 25 years of practical experience in KM in big multinational companies such as Schlumberger, Areva, Schneider Electric, and so on. And finally, in his spare time, Louis writes scientific papers and books about communities of practice. Of course, I'm kidding, he doesn't have any spare time, but he certainly still does contribute to thought leadership within the area of communities of practice. And so without further ado, welcome, Louis-Pierre. You have the podium.
Thank you, Jim. So good afternoon, good morning, depending on where you are on the planet. So I'm very glad and excited to be with you today to speak about communities of practice, virtual communities, and how they contribute to innovation. So Jim told you a lot about me. So a bit more things, I was also received the MAKE Award with my team the same year in 2007, alongside the MAKE Award, the KM World Award, and the EPQC paper on next-gen communities. But I have a conviction. My conviction is about communities. And why? Because sharing and reusing knowledge, for me, only takes place where you trust people. And trust exists only, or mainly, but only for me, within communities in a general sense. So for me, communities is a kind of a cornerstone of many activities we have ourselves with people, whether it is at work or elsewhere with peers. I'm also vice president of COP1, COP1 in French. You see, I'm fresh, I'm based in Paris. COP1 is a community of practitioners of knowledge management, Francophone ones based in Paris with people from France and Belgium. And also I'm in the Knowledge Communities Observatory, also dealing with communities. And we are planned to issue a book next year on communities of practice. So I'm very involved into this domain. So what I'm going to talk about today, communities, what they are for. I'm sure you know about it, where we'll be doing a bit more focus. Communities in companies. The use case of virtual communities, I will give you two cases of where virtual communities have helped innovation. And I will finish by three main drivers for success in terms of communities. So what brings us today here? Yes, you guys are 28 now in this call. And you know that you need to keep innovating despite the constraint that we have today. Constraint because we have this issue of the COVID, so we need to work remotely, work from home, teleworking. The teams are no more together. The communities that we are forming are scattered everywhere. And we still need to continue innovating. We also would like to hear from lessons learned from communities that do innovate, that what we call innovation communities. And there are many lessons learned we like to know and how they do it, how they make it happen. We know that we need to lead remotely. Before that, many companies had communities or practice that were, let's say, located physically in one building or one country, and people were meeting every month physically. And now they are stuck, so they need to do that remotely. So the leaders who were loosely leading the group now has to lead remotely a group of people, a community of practice, and that is something different. It's sometimes it is new for people to do this remote leadership of communities. We also know that we don't have enough time to be in these communities, and how can we justify the time that we can spend on that? There are some roadblocks about culture. Why should we be in communities? Why don't you work and spend your time delivering rather than wasting time discussing with your peer? We know that collaborative tools can have an issue, can be very powerful to enable virtual communities, but we also know that there is a problem of usage. People have some issues with using the tools properly. And as you know, if you are in a webinar and you see the speaker having issues with the tool, with controlling the noise of the others and so on, you don't want to stay. So usage is very important. Valorization is also a big concern. How do you valorize the work of the of your peers within these communities to show to management that what you've done makes sense and has some value, this overall value for the business, for the clients, and for yourself as a member? And finally, the risk of communitarism, which means that the community stays by itself, don't want to get to receive any more fresh blood, and flatters the way like a rose flatters after a while if you don't put some more water or some more nutriment to make it grow. So that's all of that goes together. So in this session, if you have questions, don't hesitate to put them on the chat, and Jim will interrupt me and ask this question for me to answer to you directly. Alors, community of practice, there are several, let's say, there are players in the company for several things. One of them is to what we call community of practice, which are piloted. They are COPP, piloted community of practice. Some of them are here to develop strategic and innovative knowledge. And I will show you examples of that where people have chosen to be together to work on specific, let's say, development of new product, new solution. And I know a company in France doing in the road business, making roads, and they have come up with a new solution to be sold to clients thanks to a committee of practice that started bottom up with some sponsorship on the top and a leader who had some vision and who was what we call an intrapreneur. It's an entrepreneur, but inside, so it's an intrapreneur who has this mindset of doing this, let's say, bottom up, unless I will do it like a startup. On the other hand, you have these other types of piloted communities of practice where people want to optimize processes, develop and formalize best practices. And you know that there are many of them everywhere where you are on the process, what is a sales process, an industrial process, and the practitioners want to be together and to fine-tune and be together, let's say, in several plans to work on how to optimize this process. And of course, you formalize, you exchange, and this company, this community is led by somebody who is usually an expert in the process, who wants to make sure that what is produced as practices are really best practice. The notion of having a sponsor is less important in this domain. Or you have some communities which can be more, let's say, bottom-up, which are there to develop competencies about a practice. It's a learning communities. People want to learn from the others, and they want to develop their own practice without being, let's say, let's say, managed or led by anything, it's kind of local things. And there are many examples of that. For example, one of the best one known is the, or start, one of the first ones is the one from Xerox. The people who are doing the maintenance of the Xerox photocopiers more than 25 years ago. And they were together after work, having a beer and discussing about their war stories, what happened to a photocopier that had some issues, and they managed to find solutions and to share how you can improve the way you repair photocopiers thanks to the input of the others. This improved their practice, then being faster, more efficient in this repair. Now, if you want to go overall in the knowledge economy, what is a community? And community is mainly a collective of mutual trust. That's why I think for me, trust is very important. If you trust your family, usually, you trust your colleague, you trust people from whom you know, from which you are close in terms of distance. And if you trust others, then you are more willing to share what you know, to share some good stories, to share some bad stories, to share some worst practice so that people can learn from mistakes. But you will only give or speak about your mistakes if you know that you will be heard and that there will be some benevolent feedback. So trust is very important. If you don't trust the others, you will not share anything. Now people are there, they interact because they want to do, they have two objectives. The common good of all and the good of each of them. Okay, I want to be better in my job. I want to be able to manage more clients. I want to be able in my research. I want to be better in what I'm doing. I want to be better in my job to have a better job afterwards. This is for me, and we interact because for the common good of everybody, we want that collectively. We, the company or our business, makes more money, does more things for the planet, for example. So we interact for this common good and for myself. That's always this bivalent types of good. How? The purpose of this community is to harness this power of collaboration. You collaborate, you work with others. Between people who are in other entities than mine. They are in several locations worldwide, in several business units, countries. I may not know them, but I want to be with them. And if we collaborate all together, all of us will be more than each of us. 1 + 1 = 3. So this power of collaboration is very important. And the way to exchange this knowledge with the others to build more knowledge is to organize it, that's one thing, but also to ritualize. It's very important, this notion of ritual. If you think about it, for example, for religion, there are rituals. We go every week to the church, to the mosque, to other places, because we ritual are very good to be all together and to continue and being in the mood of always believing and exchanging with the others. If you are in an association, you ritualize your weekly meeting, monthly meeting with the others to exchange. So if you want to lose weight, you ritualize the fact that you want to go to the gym every week, you want to swim, you want to run. If you don't ritualize, you forget to do things and then it goes away. So for a community to continue exchanging and people feeling the sense of collectiveness, rituals are very important. And that's the role of the leader of the community to ensure that there are some rituals like webinars every month, yearly events, some working groups, which are organized so that we know that things happen. And finally, the mission of the community is to enhance this value of knowledge that we exchange, to be so that we can valorize it and capitalize and reuse it. The value is in the reuse of the knowledge that has been exchanged, capitalized. And finally, the notion of leadership. When you lead a community of practice, and I'm sure that many of them, some of them have done that already, you realize that it's like you were herding cats. People are, cats, you know, are independent, and but you want them to be, to follow, let's say, the purpose of the community and to be together. And if you manage to lead a community of practice where people have, on which you have, on whom you have no authority, and you're able to make sure that the group commonly will go somewhere, then it's a key competency of management this year, because then you're able to lead any types of groups in a company, whether it is functional teams, project teams, because you know how to lead people with your influence and not with your, let's say, your power. So leadership of the community is a key competency. And I know some people who were community leaders, then were nominated directors of a function or a transverse group because they have shown their ability to lead people. Communities is a term that has very meaning, and that's a bit shameful in a sense, because the tools make people believe that communities is a tool. And if you look at softwares like, you know, Yammer, Lumap, Jalios, all this offering of software in a box that allows you to have an intranet and to have some conversation, social networks, they all tell you, you are going to create communities. Just click here, and then you have your community already running on the tool, and people just need to go, subscribe, and discuss. And here you are, you have a community. Not really. You have people who have subscribed to a website, to a group, and if they are not that many, it will not work because they will not exchange freely and easily unless there are some good reasons for. So having a tool does not mean you have a community. You have people who subscribe to a group of discussion. Communities have also other meanings. In some companies, management says we have communities everywhere. For example, there is the community of HR, the community of IT. Instead of saying we have the function of the BU, we have a community, because community is much more, I would say, cool than saying I am leading a function or a BU. But in practice, a community is not a business. It is not a function. It is a group of people, independent, who have chosen to be together because they want to devote some time and energy for the good of the group. We also have many programs of transformation that are leveraging ambassadors network, and that are called also community. So when you look at it, the community ultimately is not an application, is not a team, it's not a project team, it's not a tool, it is a group of people that is together to be together, to share ideas, share knowledge, interact, and not something, not a group that is there to deliver something for the business. Now, there is a sense of urgency about communities. We know that organization silo do not facilitate innovation. We know that we have innovation like that. We have these labs here, lab here. They are doing their own research. They don't contact, and that's a problem. You also the NIH syndrome, the not invented here syndrome, that prevents us from saying best practice because we tend to believe that what we do here is better than elsewhere. I recall a story in my former company of this community about improving processes. And they told me, well, you know, where in Europe, these best practices from China are not good because we are better because we are the European guys, we are the headquarter, the Chinese are a subsidiary, they started their plant 10 years ago, ours is 20 years or 30 years older, blah, blah, blah. And same thing with the Americans versus the French. So you see all these stories. And in practice, they realized that people were sharing their practices in their continent, North America, Europe, and Asia, but not between, because they had this preconceived notion that, well, it was better among us than the others. And the third sense of agency is the constraint of physical distance. Because when you reduce on-site meetings, what do you do? How do you enable these types of virtual community? And for many people, it's a big change. I am consulting now some clients, industrial clients, who said, well, you know, we had the meetings between our plants every month. Now the meetings are gone. How do we do? The leader of the community is is a very good expert, but he has no ability to lead a group remotely with communication and so on. I need help. And that's one of these issues that we are faced with. So I will stop speaking and I will ask you a question. And you can answer on the chat. You know, on the right of your screen, there is a chat button in the chat and you can write a message. And the message is, in your opinion, how could communities help innovation in your organization? So it is you now. Your feedback is very important. So I let you answer in the chat and I shut up for a couple of minutes. Thank you, Jim. Increasing the diversity of ideas, crowdsourcing ideas, democratizing participation, giving people a voice. Thank you, Marissa. Thank you, John. Rebecca, communities would facilitate cross-org learning and sharing. Yep. What else? Ideation. Thank you, Catherine. Beth could lead to better employee engagement. That's true. Agree with you. Employee engagement is a very interesting concept. Huh? How do you engage people? It is true that that's one of the reasons why companies do that. There is a story. Ah, Jean-Claude. Hello, Jean-Claude. Share success stories. Mutual cause. I give you one for employee engagement. I know a French company, quite known in the telecom business. And this company went from a state-owned company to a privately owned company. Sorry, in English, would be publicly owned. Publicly owned by shareholders, and they come from state-owned to publicly owned. And they had some problem of people having some issues because they were no more civil servants. This company had some suicides that took place because people were totally shocked by this change of world for them, from civil servant to public company. And it chose to have communities with the interesting social network where people could exchange, and it had built some engagement of the employees. It had the engagement of the employees through this social network, so that the members of the employees of this company newly created would be more inclined to share and exchange. The company is Orange, if you know. It's a big telecom company in Europe. Success stories, that's for sure. Because if you share success stories, then you are able to learn from the others what works. And then you are more willing to reuse and to adapt the story to your own environment. Matthew, provide variety, perspective, issues across line. Yes, true. Because diversity is key in a community. of a practice. You have diversity, then people are more inclined to share. A safe environment to share challenges and difficulties. Yes, and they are thinking about an example of that. Oh yes, I know one. I know in a company, they have launched a community of president of their BUs in countries. Like they had one country, had one president for the business, and they had about presence in about 50 countries worldwide. And this president, they were basically God in their country because they were running the business, but they were alone because when do I get help to be better in my role as the president of the country? And in that case, the company chose to create a community of practice of presidents led by a former president of a country. And together, they managed to share some stories and tips on how to be better in my role, how to be better sharing, having my P&L, how do I deal better with people, how do I deal better with the politics, and so that the younger or junior country president could learn from their peers who had more experience in running a country. And it was safe because it was closed, totally close only to country president, which allowed them to share stories and problems because they knew trust was there because they were only with their peers. What else can I say about that? So crowdsourcing ideas, yes, that's very important, crowdsourcing. I'm sure you know the IBM Jam. IBM have launched something called Jam, like jam in blues, in jazz, where they crowdsourced to 10 of thousands of people ideas with some of brainstorming like we do now with the chat. And that's the best way to get input from people in a large scale, and then having a way to get ideas and then to come up with some solution to this idea. So the crowdsourcing is very important and very useful when you are doing communities, and post-its that you see today on the screen can be replaced by tools like Klaxoon. I don't know if you know Klaxoon. It's a French company that also has a foot in the US, and that one of the key features is the board when you can do post-its. Very important when you want to share ideas and to do some brainstorming. Cool. No more idea. Okay, so let's move on to the rest. So thank you for your feedback. Very nice from you. Now, what is at stake about what we said before? So we want to these communities and companies behind, if they do communities of practice, like I've been working with a big French Belgian companies, and they have a program of communities. The company is called ENGIE, and ENGIE has a very strong program of communities. It also had been studied by EPQC, and one of their goal is to support innovation, obviously, because you really want to make sure that you can foster networks and to share new idea, new knowledge. And of course, you want to be better. For example, when you integrate, when you purchase a new company, you want to make sure that what you get from this company that you purchase goes into your company, and vice versa, that what you know will go to the new company. And that when you, in the purchasing process, that the sharing takes place before the company is fully acquired. So it's very important to have these communities can help in this domain as well. So efficiency, creative efficiency, we know what we know it's important to do that. And the capital of the people, we know that the value now in big companies are the people. If they flee, you get only the shell of the company, what is behind. So communities, I know I've been in integration team at Schlumberger when we acquired a company when I was there. And one of the things is we wanted to use communities of practice of Schlumberger to ensure that the people in this acquired company called SEMA, at that time an IT company, were, continuing to exchange and to bring value. And we identified three main, processes that needed to be supported by communities. One was bid management, one was project management, and the last one was people management when you, in a service company, when you need to make sure that the people are allotted to the correct projects. And I was in charge of the bid management community, and we had everybody doing bids were together, and this community was very efficient in sharing knowledge about the bids, how I can get help, where I can get information about the clients, the prospect, or the technology, which will allow me to be better, to do a better bid. And this allowed people to be developed because they were better in their job. So they learned from their peers through this community of bid management. So I will show you two use cases related to that. So this is a transportation company, and it wants to position itself to an innovative market on transportation. And it spans many countries with many employees, most of them being drivers, but not all of them, obviously. And this is, since they are dealing in the transportation market, their clients are cities, regions, sometimes countries, but usually it is cities or regions or states, and they want to win contract with innovative ideas so that these clients can issue some call for tenders that will contain requests that this company will be able to answer. So they need first to convince the decision makers in these cities or states that what they propose makes sense for the future transportation. For this to work, they launched a piloted community of practice strategic on how to explore these innovative markets on the transport on demand. And they basically regrouped people from several BUs functions, people from the operations, from the sales, from innovation, who had an interest or a passion for this domain of transport on demand. And they created a community of practice with all these people, about 200 members worldwide, with a leader from the headquarters. And they used their internal social network to bind together these people, plus they did some webinars, they issued some white papers, they had websites for people to get information about bids that were ongoing or finalized, and ideas on how to sell, how to package this new offering to prospect. And this community of practice helped a lot diffuse this notion of this new market, this new domain, to the various countries where the company was located, thanks to this webinars and discussions among the members. And they improved their competencies because they were able to learn from their peers how to make a better offering, better proposal, and how to make sure that the prospect, the city, would be more inclined to listen to their argumentation. Of course, to this to work, they had to be rigorous. They had to have some regular events to ritualize, as I said before. They ritualized their events like monthly webinars where different people each time were proposing, showing what happened in their countries on the domain. And they had some rigor in terms of deciding what would be the topics, how to organize things so that people will be welcome and will be inclined to be present and to be part of this group. And of course, it worked quite fine. The second one is on innovation with suppliers. So different context, it's a big industrial company, and you have the R&D department. Of course, it's in the electricity business, and it's about plastic. And the idea is, okay, plastic is at the heart of any company doing industrial material but with electricity, because it's an insulator. So R&D, of course, wants to make the best insulator possible for the products. Purchasing department, of course, want to purchase, to source the cheapest plastic that meets the requirement of R&D. But when you see overall, you see there is a need for the company to show some, I would say, green credentials. They make sure that the plastic is recyclable, that it will not pollute the planet, that they can reuse all the plastic for their goods. So in a sense, to be sustainable, so that they can show to their stakeholders, to their that they are in a good way toward the usage of plastic. So then there is this issue, how can we together the R&D and purchasing and everybody who is in plastic in this company work on this portfolio, which is sustainable, while also being able to foresee the new changes in environmental regulations, for example, REACH in Europe, to ensure that there will be one step in advance to the regulation so that they will prepare their factories to be ready when the regulation is in place. So they chose to create a committee of practice open to anybody from R&D and purchasing and beyond on this topic of plastic. And they had this committee piloted by a leader with a sponsor who was from one of the top people in purchasing. And they used once again the social network because they were scattered worldwide. So they had once again events, webinars, discussions. They also had some working groups to tackle some specific issues. For example, they had some working groups on how can we deliver a standard for the company about plastic usage. So it's not the big boss who wrote the standard. This is the community that together worked on issuing, proposing a standard for the company. And the benefit of this community was to provide this vision for the company, for it to be able to answer what will be at stake tomorrow. And on the other hand, to secure procurement, to ensure that when we have some issues, we know that the impact on our raw material will be this way, and we'll be able to ensure that the company in the long run will make money, sell the product, and being as green as possible. Of course, there were two cultures, R&D, purchasing, so two community leaders to lead the stuff, so manage these two cultures, and once again, ritual. So we had some questions, but the questions are mostly for the end. Catherine asked for the end. So that was number two. This, once again, innovation with the suppliers. One of the goals, of course, is to extend this community beyond the company to the suppliers so that some people in these suppliers will be part of the community to, of course, bring some more value to the company and have a two-way benefit so that they will know in advance what the company will have as a vision, so that the supplier will be able to answer more precisely what the company wants. So it's important to move away from the community inside the wall and to open the wall to outside. So in a sense, what are the main three drivers for success for basically communities? One is around culture. And you have to ask yourself several questions. Is your organizational culture flexible in terms of cross-functional interaction? In a sense, the independence of the hierarchy between people and experts? Is the organization encouraging the sharing of knowledge? Sometimes it doesn't. Has your organization a culture strongly focused on innovation and co-creation among people who are dispersed worldwide and not only within only one site? Does the culture of the company encourage interpersonal relationship and stimulate the creation and the management of networks with people who are outside of your own site, outside of your own team and elsewhere? Does it reward climate, and does it reward, I would say, some transparent relationship? Are you able to say what you think or what you believe should be done without the risk of being, I would say, banged on the head? Is there a capacity for change in this company when there is a change of business needs? I give you an example for the culture in this kind of transparent relationship. In a company where I worked, when the social network was launched, there were, of course, some managers which were not happy because some discussions were about topics that they believe were their own turf, were on their own domain. And I recall one guy who was the vice president telling me, oh, Louis-Pierre, you know, I've posted something on the social network about blah, blah, blah. And I received from my boss a message that vice president elsewhere was not happy about what I have posted because it was about his business. And I told him, okay, it's not nice. But do you recall that 3 months before, we did the same thing to somebody else I know, who told me that you had contacted his boss to tell you are not happy. So sometimes people don't realize that because they want to defend their turf, they are, let's say, hampering. They are not very nice on the others. And myself, I receive sometimes some requests from boss saying, hey, somebody in your team says that, please ask him to remove the post. And I said, no. What she said was, according to the rules of the company in terms of freedom of expression, there was nothing derogatory in what they said. So I will not ask him or her to remove the post. So the second thing is community management. It's also a big driver for success. And you have to ask yourself if there are some strategies to promote the communities inside the company, like videos, communication, or initiatives to involve the community members and to stimulate their contribution. For example, if some people do share some best practice, are you able to advertise some best practice, some reuse of best practice that worked well, so that basically they can be, let's say, recognized as such? Are there some roles and actions in place throughout the community operation? For example, are there some roles like community leaders? Is there a central team to organize all the communities in the company, like a central community management group, like my group I had in Schneider, and like Eureka, for example, in Schlumberger? Is there some trainings provided for community leaders so that they know how to lead their communities? Are there enough time dedicated to the sharing of best practices? Do the leaders of communities have enough time to lead their communities, which takes about 20% minimum of their time? And if we don't have community management, let's say, program or governance globally, then it will be much more difficult to enable communities. And finally, are there tools available for the purpose of communication inside these communities? Do we have the Yammer, the Slack, the Teams of the world, which allow things to work? Does the enterprise social network, does it exist? Are we able to share ideas and find experts? Or is it only a top-down tool used by the chief to push some news and not a bottom-up where people can, let's say, give some advice and give ideas and share news or share content? Do you have document management tools to provide support to managing content and document, which are reference material for the rest of the company? And do you have people who have time allocated to the maintenance of the content so that it is up to date? So all of that goes into a practice of this main driver for success. If you don't have the right culture, the communities of practice virtual, and you have the enablers for that, and if you don't have modern collaborative tools, then it will be much more difficult to have this innovation through communities that would take place into your company. And voilà. So if you want to know more, you know my website. I wrote an article called Afraid of Engagement. It's available on the Knowledge Management Research and Practice. It is available. I co-wrote a book called Innovation Community of Innovation. It's in French. It will be translated in English next year. And I have written several articles as well. You can find me on LinkedIn and so on. So if you want to know more, don't hesitate to contact me. I will give you some insight. So there are some questions. Catherine, give me your questions. What would I say for keeping community of practice flourishing once launched? Well, launching a community is easy. Having it flourish over time, it's a bit more difficult. And once again, ritual for me. It's important of interest. You have to know what your, it's like a company. You have to know what your clients want. So you have to survey your members and to find out what do they want as members. Do you provide them with what they want? So you have to ask them every year, what would be the topic you would like the community to work on or to exchange during the year, for example, so that you have some ammunition in terms of what would be the topics we should work on, or having their feedbacks about your events. Are the events interesting or not? So collecting the feedback of your members allows ensures that you will provide what people want. One thing also is to make sure that the leader rotates. Don't keep the same leader for 10 years. I know some companies where the leaders, especially in technical communities or R&D, have said forever. It is not good. After 3 years, people should change to have new blood and new ideas. So that's one way is to rotate new blood, listen to your clients, i.e. listen to your members, and ritualize so people know that, oh, things will happen and I will continue coming. And the pitfall for standing up new communities, I would say, is to believe that everything can be a community. That is only because you are the boss and you want to create a community. I want a community on that and on that, and I'm going to nominate that person to be the leader. Let's write the charter, and here we are. It's not like that. It won't work if you don't have a desire of people. So you really, when you starting up, you want to create one, you want to make sure that you have enough people with an interest or a passion on the topic, or if you have enough people in the same métier, in the same role, that will warrant an interest to be all together. It also depends on the types of work people have. I've noticed that people in finance and HR are much less willing to be in communities than people, for example, in R&D or in technical job. So depending on your culture in the company, don't make sure that what you do correspond to the needs. If you have enough people who have a need, then a community will work out.
Louis-Pierre, we have a similar question in the Zoom chat, but in the interest of being sure that all the voices are heard, let me ask it on their behalf and if you have any additional advice. The question is, as a company looking to kick off a knowledge management community of practice, what advice can you give on how to kick this off successfully and to ensure that it maximizes value to the organization?
If you want to launch one community of practice, the first thing is to align the interest of the community with the interest of the business. Because ultimately, there is a, when you look at the three main, I would say, key factors that enable the community to be active, I would say, is first to have a leader that has enough time to lead the group. Second is trust among the members. And the third one is the alignment of my job, my role, with the purpose of the community. So if the community follows, goes along with some, the strategy of the business, then people are more inclined to be a member of it because they know that it will benefit the business and themselves. If you look at the community of plastic, plastic was a very important part of the business of that company, and having this, I would say, being able to show that they are more green with plastic was very important. So that case was strategic. So hence, it was easy to convince people to be with that. And so that's why you have to always to wonder, what does I bring? What do I bring for the business in terms of, do I align my company objectives, my community objective, with my company objectives?
Wonderful. Here's something I think would be of value to our attendees, because likely many of them are community leaders themselves or will be. Do you have any personal advice or advice for them personally on how to be successful community managers beyond what you briefly talked about at the top of your discussion?
Successful community leader. Well, first, you need to be a good communicator, especially if it's virtual. Of course, empathy. You are not leading. You're leading from behind, in a sense. You put forward the others. What you should not do, for example, when you are having webinars, is to be the one speaking, doing all the blah, 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 because people will get fed up. So, in a sense, you have to... in fact, grow others in the community and have others being to recognize others and show them and make sure that the people will grow up and be more visible. So you're here to help others and not to serve yourself first. So empathy, ability to lead, and let others be in the front seat.
Great. You may note a question from Matthew in the feed loop.
Yeah, I saw that
chat. So I'll let you go ahead and respond to that.
So there is some rule of thumbs with size of communities. Between, I would say, 50 and 200, that's the correct size of a community. If it's too small, below 50, it's going to be very difficult to have enough people who are willing to exchange and to be active in this community. Because rule of thumb is about, you know, the famous 10% of people are active, the 90% are basically lurkers, watchers. So 10% of 50 is only 5, not easy. Up to 200, people are very easily together. If you go beyond 200, the community is large, and you may end up with several topics about several domains that may not interest everybody because there will be too diverse a profile of the people, and there will be ultimately you need to split the community towards a smaller number because too many people makes it too active, too many topics and you are lost in them as a member. Notice that the 200 is also called the Dunbar number. Mr. Dunbar found that the ideal size of a group, whether it is apes or primitive humans, is about 200, because that's the number of which the boss or the leader of the team knows everybody. Beyond 200 people, you don't know all the names of all your people. The same thing in some plants. They don't grow too much because you want to know everybody. So 50 to 200 is a good size for me. Below 50, it is very difficult, especially if it's a virtual community. Ah, les zombie community. But I would say I would be like a bit Darwinist. Hein? If you have zombie communities, they will die by themselves. People will leave, and after a while, it will die by lack of members. So if you are leading a program of communities, of course, the best way is to ask every year each of the leaders, do you have a sponsor? Do you have a charter? What is your plan? And if you see that some communities are not answering after a while, bah, you put them beside and people will forget, they will leave it and they will become zombies. Hein? I will not close them by force. They will close by themselves after a while. I'm more concerned with, with communities that start very well on the enterprise social network. And that could be communities of practice, but don't want to be there because there is nobody who wants to be in charge to lead it. That's a bit more, I would say, annoying. But having the zombies dying probably is much more on the zombies who are the ones who are watching this community and not being part of it. It's a bit annoying when you have 1,000 followers of your Yammer group and you have only 50 people in your webinars. Then, of course, you are a bit annoyed by having very few, lot of zombies and very few real members.
We're near the conclusion of our time, and I want to give you the last moment, Louis-Pierre, to say your final remarks. But before that, on behalf of KM World Connect and our attendees, thank you for sharing your expertise with us today. For our attendees, don't forget to rejoin us for the next session in our communities track. And until then, please do visit the virtual exhibit hall as well as attending the keynotes. So again, the last moments for you, Louis-Pierre.
My last moment, it would be, well, I really enjoyed. Thank you for all of your questions that were very interesting. I love questions. I love the brainstorming was great. And I hope to see you maybe next year in the next KM World physical event.